A very good evening to all the members attending this meet. On behalf of Department of Pediatric Surgery, Nilofer Hospital of Child Health, Osmania Medical College, I welcome you all for today's session, case presentation of posterior urethral valves. Our today's guest faculty here, we have with us Dr. Minu Bajpai sir, who is one of the stalwarts of our fields. Sir is presently professor and head of the department in the Department of Pediatric Surgery. Yeah. All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. Sir has been president of Indian Association of Pediatric Surgery in 2014. He has up to 2 articles published to his credit in various national and international journals. And he has been honored with many awards for his achievements. So we welcome you, sir, for today's case-based discussion. A one-year-old male child, Ritik, resident of Adilabad, with mother as informant, who is a reliable informant, brought the child with chief complaints of passing cloudy urine since 1 week, fever since 3 days, and excessive cry while passing urine since 3 days. History of present illness. Patient was apparently asymptomatic 1 week back. Then he started passing cloudy urine since 1 week. And there was history of fever, which was low grade since 3 days, which subsided on taking oral medication. There's history of excessive cry with straining while passing urine. There's no history of dribbling, no history of hematuria, no history of prior catheterization, no history of umbilical discharge, no history of constipation, no history of abdominal distension, no history of vomitings, no history of feed intolerance or loss of weight, no history of any significant antenatal history, and there is no history of any documented UTI episodes or similar complaints in the past. Past history. The child was hospitalized at 5 months of age in view of shortness of breath in local private hospital, and he was diagnosed as bronchopneumonia and treated accordingly. At the time of admission, ultrasound abdomen was not done, as told by mother, sir. Antenatal history, so non-consanguineous marriage, it was antenatally registered, and 2 antenatal scans were done, which were normal. There was no history of any oligohydramnios in antenatal scan.
क्या?
Sir.
हाँ जी. हाँ.
Perinatal history. He's a first child, term born delivered by lower segment cesarean section. Cried immediately after birth with birth weight of 2.9 kgs. Child was exclusively breastfed. There were no urinary complaints after birth. Immunization history. Child was immunized up to date as per schedule. Developmental history. Milestones are achieved as per age. Treatment history. For the present complaint, no treatment was taken. And family history is not significant. Shall I continue, sir?
Please continue. So basically, in the history of presentation and at presentation, what was the chief complaint? You said that his child has presented the age of 1 year.
Yes, sir.
There was a recent history of only 1 week, except that at 5 weeks of age or 5 months of age, he was hospitalized.
Yes, for sir. Respiratory. 5 months. Yes, sir.
5 months of age. And, yes, sir. And there was no, at that time also, there was, at least you don't have any available information on history related to urinary tract, is it?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So suppose you are with this history. Now, these are times we have all learned during this COVID times that we are often asked by teleconsultation to discuss their cases. The families reach out to us. We reach out to families, our OPDs, so that we get to know as to what are the presentation. And with this history, what are the various things which come to your mind? See, the chief complaint and the history of present illness. So with this, you should learn how to, during teleconsultation, think very broadly, as far as possible, think about various possibilities with the chief complaint. And so what are the salient features of this case around which you would like to further dig deeper?
So firstly, the mother might not have noticed any low-grade fever or any urinary stream problems, sir. She might have missed.
No. Harisha. Harisha, tell what is in your mind with this history. What are the possibilities?
Yeah. But don't get carried away that we are treating or dealing with a particular diagnosis. Just widen up. This is a one opportunity only. As you will see other cases and make presentation, you start opening up. We have a case here. We have the child is very far away from me, and they are asking for symptoms to be addressed. And you would ask them, well, you have these symptoms. Think about various possibilities so that you can choose a particular set of investigation, one after the other. And you this way try to hone down and narrow down to the diagnosis. Harisha, have you understood what Dr. Naren has told you? And okay,
yes, sir.
Please.
Yes, sir. I did.
Yes.
So, with this history, there might be a possibility of febrile urinary tract infection, sir.
Okay.
And
yes, so there is a, so if you are, we are asked you to crisply look at salient features of this case, a male child presenting at the age of 1 year with a 1 week history of lower urinary tract symptoms, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
And with this, so a male child with lower urinary tract symptoms, you were right. So it's a febrile urinary tract, which means there could be some infection. But there is also a dictum that there could be bladder outlet obstruction. And therefore, you should start thinking in those terms.
Yes,
so
sir.
What are the two main possibilities you would, or rather two or three possibilities you will keep?
So the most common cause of bladder outlet obstruction being posterior urethral valve, sir.
Right. That's one. Secondly?
And it could be a vesicoureteric reflex, sir. With
okay. Reflex may lead to dysuria because of the infection. So it may also present with difficulty in passing urine. Okay.
Yes, sir.
What else?
And there might be bilateral. There might be.
This could be at 1 year of age. At 1 year of age.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. At 1 year of age, what else it could be?
You can think as widely as possible, because obviously once you have a thought process of very wide horizontal view, then you can start toning down. Well, I have thought about neurogenic bladder, but you will ask the family, well, is there something at the back lesion, or there was some problem or injury, whatever. All children, generally we have only spina bifida kind of thing. But you should have to think about all these. Then you narrow down. You rule out one after the other, but think very broadly. So you are right. You talk about PUV, dysuria is the result of UTI. Fine. What else?
And then it could be...
Any history of constipation, Harisha?
In this child, there is no history of constipation, sir. But constipation might lead to like retention of urine, sir.
Bladder bowel dysfunction. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Good. What else? So Dr. Naren gave you a little hint. At 1 year. So at 1 year, the child has already been weaned. He is now on semi-solid and solid diet. He could be developing a functional constipation, isn't it? So think about those. Please keep thinking.
You said outlet obstruction, Harisha.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Outlet obstruction. What else you think at 1 year of age?
Obstructive
pathology.
Yes, sir. There should there could be megaureters, sir.
Bladder outlet obstruction, you are talking about megaureter. You said bladder outlet obstruction.
Yes, sir.
So, what are the obstructive phenomena in the entire urethra? What else you can think of?
Prostatic utricle, sir.
Okay.
Any secourethrocele, sir.
Excellent. Excellent.
Good.
And
the commonest condition.
Any urethral calculus, sir.
Okay, good. Right, go on.
good. So basically, you have thought about as many possibilities which can be there. Some are common, some are less common. You could have a evolving pelvic mass. Can it happen?
Yes, sir. It could be. And any tumors which could compress on bladder, sir.
Yes, yes. Bladder outlet, you can have a rhabdo also. Although little older children come, but you can mention this and then try to rule it out.
Yes, sir.
And yes.
And any presacral masses, sir.
Yes, yes, correct. Correct. Pelvic mass, it will include a whole range of pelvic masses can be there. You yes, can have sir. Even rarely, although rare, you can think talk about even Prun-Willi syndrome and then rule it out. So the opportunity is there for the examiner and for you, for the patient in teleconsultation to think about a whole spectrum. So your wider knowledge is available. And yes, then sir. With more history of present illness, ruling out something, including other things, you will come down to a set of 3 or 4 possibilities, which will then be built up further with imaging. Ask for investigations. Well, let me ask this investigation. So this approach should continue for every case. Please go ahead. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Will come distally.
Sir?
Will come distally.
More distally, he is saying. So you come to from posterior urethra or low bladder outlet to lower down. What are the things which we often see in the males? Some sort of?
Any syringocils or?
Diverticulum? Diverticulum? Metal stenosis, isn't it?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Metal stenosis. What is the name of that diverticulum? Antenatal diverticulum?
Yes, sir. Could be.
Okay. So what is the history we will take? So now that you have got these possibilities, you see, this child has presented with a specific symptom. You are trying to build up the possibilities. So your examiner asks you, well, more distally, so think about more distal causes.
Distal.
ठीक है अभी बताया.
Phimosis.
Yeah, that's one of the causes they present with urea and bladder outlet obstruction.
Okay, Arisha.
Sir.
Anything you want to add? Otherwise, you can proceed with examination.
Anything you want to add, Harisha? Otherwise, proceed.
The distal obstructions, I'm thinking over, sir.
You have mentioned about phimosis, metal stenosis, anterior diverticulum. Rarely there could be a polyp, which may not be distal. It could be in the posterior urethra also, isn't it? Yes, so all these are there in the track. Rarely stone. It's a very young child for a stone to be thought of.
Yes.
Okay. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Because it's not pointing to any of the history is not pointing to any of the possibilities, one single possibility. So it is a chance for you to enumerate all what are all the bladder outlet obstructions. So you can think of all these things, you can enumerate, and for discussion sake, you can tell them.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
May I proceed, sir?
Yeah, please. Proceed.
Yes, sir. On general examination of the patient, child is conscious, alert, well-built and nourished. A mild pallor is present. There is no icterus, no cyanosis, no clubbing, no generalized lymphadenopathy and no pedal edema. Child is afebrile with pulse rate of 110 beats per minute and respiratory rate of 28 per minute. Blood pressure is 80/60 mmHg. Anthropometry, weight of the child is 10 kgs with height of 74 centimeters. Midarm circumference is 12 centimeters. All are appropriate for the age of the child. No examination, no syndromic features, and no swellings over the back, no evidence of any neural or musculoskeletal abnormalities. This is a clinical picture, sir.
Mega.
Carry on, Harisha.
Yes, sir. Coming to the abdominal examination with child in supine position, on inspection, abdomen is flat with umbilicus in the center and inverted. Flanks are free. All the quadrants are moving equally with respiration. There is no suprapubic bulge noted. And hernial orifices are free.
The time of presentation, Harisha.
Sir?
What is about at the time of presentation of the case? Now the bladder is catheterized. When you examine, obviously you won't find any suprapubic fullness.
Sir, the picture is taken after catheterization, sir, but on inspection findings have been outpatient, sir. On inspection, there is no suprapubic bulge, sir. On inspection.
The time of admission of this case, sir, have you taken the history from the case?
Yes,
what
sir.
What is written in that? Even that you can mention. Because now catheterized, you won't find any suprapubic bulge as of now.
Yes, sir. These are the findings, sir, at the time of admission
itself.
Normal external genitalia with Foley's catheter. After catheterization, Foley's catheter is in situ. And on palpation, there is no local rise of temperature and no tenderness. Abdomen is soft. Palpable bladder is noted. Can be felt. Renal angles are free. No organomegaly. External genitalia are normal with bilateral descendant testis in the scrotum.
Go ahead.
Yes, sir.
So now, since you are now describing, once you finish this part, we'll ask you that, as Dr. Narendra also said, that suppose the child was not catheterized and he has come to you, the child has come to the casualty, yes, and sir, you would like to examine the child from top to down. So you will have to look at his facies also.
Yes,
look,
sir,
at his facies, yes, his chest, okay, deformity, all, yes, this, sir, thing we will ask you. So what you can do is, at the moment, whatever findings you have, you put it together. Then, yes, we will discuss with you as to, suppose the child has come naive to you without any intervention, no catheterization. How would you like to elicit the child from top to bottom so that, yes, at least you can include some things that you have enumerated in your DD and rule out others? Okay.
Yes, got, sir, the... Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Go ahead, please.
So on percussion, there was dull note felt over the suprapubic region, and on auscultation, bubble sounds are heard. Systemic examination, cardiovascular system is normal, no murmurs heard. Respiratory system, bilateral air entry is present. Central nervous system is normal, and musculoskeletal system is also normal, sir. So at the end of the history, to summarize the case, 1-year-old male child with complaints of passing dusky urine since 1 week, excessive cry while micturition, and with low-grade fever since 3 days, no history of dribbling and failure to thrive. On examination, palpable bladder is noted. My provisional diagnosis at the end of...
Stop there.
Yes, sir.
Sir, you can ask the questions.
Yeah, so basically now, Harisha, as, yes, you, sir, were saying, that you have a set of features at presentation. Yes, and, sir, you elicited this on a teleconsultation or in a one-to-one talk with the family about the history of present illness. So you, yes, basically wanted to elicit how the child presented, what was the past history, was there any pointer about possibilities. Since there was not much was coming to your rescue, you thought about a range of possibilities. So the, yes, range of possibilities that you tried to look for them in the examination also. Now, during the examination, from, yes, head, sir, to toe, suppose I ask you, what are Potter faces?
Yes, sir. Potter faces, it's nothing but due to oligohydramnios, the facial features, they'll be squashed up, and there'll be presence of recessed chin, flattened and depressed nasal bridge, and hypertelorism will be there, sir, and low set ears without cartilage, and prominent epicanthal folds.
Very good. So low set ears, weak nose, prominent epicanthal fold, all very rightly said. Slanting, yes, of the eyes is difficult. Why does it all happen?
Because the child doesn't have enough space to grow, sir, when there is a decreased lycra.
Right. Right. So basically, in a child who presents to you with bladder outlet obstruction, in a male child where chances of posterior third valve are very common, you have to start looking at what may be happening. And once you envisage that, so there is an obstruction at the posterior urethra, and then whether posterior urethra or anterior urethra, any fetal outlet obstruction would lead to back pressure effect on the urethra, on the bladder. Bladder consists of the detrusor wall as well as the bladder neck. They are all part of the same detrusor component. So there will be bladder neck hypertrophy, there will be reflux, there will be dilated ureter, there will be effect on the mesoderm developing kidneys. During embryopathy, during organogenesis, since this obstruction is there right from first trimester, the development of the organogenesis is getting affected. So all the organs which are developing and which are proximal to this obstruction would have varying degrees of dysfunction and maldevelopment. Mm. So you can start, all this would happen. So basically, when you're looking at a child, and since the child starts passing urine from the first trimester in the fetus, fetus starts passing urine in the first trimester. So amniotic fluid doesn't get built up. And this amniotic fluid is a cushion in which the baby swims. Now, because of the oligohydramnios, there is a compression effect, as you said, that the child gets compressed by the uterus, and this leads to two major things. One, the body's configuration, the physical structure which you enumerated, Potter facies, and inside the chest, what is happening?
There will be pulmonary hypoplasia, sir.
Very good. So the child, the nourishment which comes from amniotic fluid is also not there because of oligopart. So all these features are there. Now you can remember. So whenever you have a baby, look for these things. And since they are not commonly seen, you can rule them out one after the other. So that was part one. What else? There was no catheter. There was no catheter. How would an abdomen look like? Possibility of an abdomen looking like.
There might be a possibility of flank fullness and abdominal distension, sir.
Very good. What could be the contributory factors for abdominal distension?
So there could be bilateral hydroureter nephrosis, which makes the flanks full, or there might be urinary ascites, sir.
Yes.
Or there might be
in a newborn. Very good. So in a neonate, you would find ascites also, because they would present much earlier. The more severe the obstruction, the more early they present. And what are the lumps which are palpable in the abdomen? Generally, lumps which are palpable, what do they come from?
Associated with bladder outlet obstruction.
Yes.
Thickened bladder is palpable, sir.
Yes,
very and good. Loins,
kidneys, renal angles will be full with palpable kidneys, sir.
Yes.
And there could be any umbilical discharge when there is patent urachus.
Fair enough. So the lumps are both kidneys and the bladder, and there could be fullness of abdomen because of ascites in a younger newborns.
Okay. Yes.
And umbilicus, you said. So what could be there in a newborn with umbilical discharge in this context?
It could be patent urachus.
Very good. Very good. So all this. So you have a child who presents to you. You had a history before that. Now you looked at from top to bottom. Then you look at the examination finding. Look at his deformities because of the oligo. Then you looked at the abdomen. Okay, so all this you have looked at. Even hernial sites sometimes are very prominent. You could have umbilical hernia also because of the same reason. Raised pressure and straining during maturation can lead to all this. So all these features are there. And in a systemic examination overall, this child's breathing, what kind of breathing would there be?
So there can be hyperventilation when the child is in metabolic acidosis, sir.
Very good. So it is not always lung hypoplasia. There is also, because of obstruction and severe obstruction, leads to metabolic acidosis. So the child would be listless, okay? Not looking very lethargic child. And as you very rightly said, this child, because of this obstruction, there will be metabolic acidosis. Fair enough. So with your findings, if you put it together, there were not many positive findings. So this child had come at 1 year. Is it a good sign or a poor sign?
It's a poor sign, sir.
So younger the baby comes is poor sign, or the little older he comes is a poor sign?
Older.
Now.
So if the newborn comes he would have poor kidneys, or 1 year comes, he has poor kidneys.
So 1 year old.
So the younger the baby comes, it means he's severely obstructed. Now this child has come at 1 year. It means had he been severely obstructed with all the consequences of back pressure effect, he would have come very early on, isn't it, Harisha?
Yes, yes, sir. Yes.
So as he grows up, as they come later and later, if you ignore a case, he's come late, it's a different matter. But overall in PUV parlance, newborns, when they come, they are having more severe disease. Older they come, they have a lesser affected. But yes. If you ignore management throughout, then obviously everything will get delayed. So all these features, you have to look for a particular case when he comes to you and you have already done it. So now you have a child in the casualty. He is now incidentally 1 year, but we will keep on discussing had he been a newborn, which is a more common presentation.
Okay.
So now you tell how would you manage this baby and what are the various possibilities you will take into consideration. Management includes making a diagnosis or confirming a diagnosis. And management also includes therapeutic interventions. In the management, when you are making a diagnosis, you mentioned about any absence of back swelling. Okay. You should have looked at the abdomen. Abdomen was abdominal wall could have offered you some pointers.
Yes, sir. If it were wrinkled, we could
very good.
We could have diagnosed prune belly syndrome, sir.
Very good. What are the other features? What are the triad features in prune belly?
Prune belly syndrome, it's abdominal wall defects, cryptorchidism, yes. And urinary tract
deformation.
Yes, sir.
Good. So this is an opportunity for you to keep thinking about other things so that your revision is the basis of memory. Every time you have an opportunity, think about other possibilities and spell them out so that it is in practice. So fair enough. You looked at the back, you looked at the abdomen, so you have ruled out pretty much a lot of other possibilities. Now, you said pelvic mass. What kind of history would you take to rule out that? Which might help you.
Yes, sir. I would ask for any history of constipation, sir.
Excellent. 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 So this is what is called the broader view of things. So you have thought about that possibility also. Fair enough. So more or less, you have covered most of the things. Dr. Naren, anything you want to ask her?
No, sir. Go ahead. Go ahead, sir.
Go ahead. Please go ahead. Yeah. So basically now we have a situation here in front of you. And at the same time, not only 1 year old, we will also transgress into newborn presentation so that we can cover the subject properly. Yes. So yes. How would you now approach the management, as I said, making a diagnosis and then intervention? So how will you confirm your diagnosis?
So in this case, because of fever and dusky urine, I would firstly catheterize the child, sir. Mm-hmm. And then I would send for urine microscopy and urine cultures. Mm-hmm. Then I'll get a ultrasound kidney, ureter and bladder done, sir.
Hmm.
And I'll stabilize.
You have the information? Yes.
Any blood investigations, biochemical?
Yes, sir. I would send for renal function test, blood urea, serum creatinine, and serum electrolytes, along with the complete blood picture.
Sutra Tilna.
You have some information on this?
Because of AC.
Yes, sir.
Reports are available to you?
Yes, sir. These are the investigations of the child, sir. Hemoglobin is 10.8 gram percent and total counts are slightly raised with 15,300 per cubic mm. And serum creat, here we can see that it is normal, 0.18 mg per deciliter. Serum electrolytes are also normal, sir. Sodium 138, potassium 4.5 and chloride 101. Urine microscopy. Pustules are 10 to 12 per hyper field. Epithelial cells are 2 to 3 per hyper field. Albumin and sugar are nil. And urine culture sensitivity has been sent, sir. This is after 3 days, sir. The report has been documented here. Klebsiella is isolated, sir.
What is the colony count?
Colony count is more than 1 lakh per hyper field.
What are the ultrasound findings you suggested? Yeah.
This is the ultrasound findings, sir.
Uh-huh. So what do you anticipate in a child with posterior urethral valve or a bladder outlet obstruction, of which PUV is the most common? In ultrasound, what are the various findings you can expect? So while you're doing it, please think about a newborn also, so that we can cover the subject, okay?
Yes, sir.
Well.
We have to see for echogenicity of the kidney, parenchymal thickness, anteroposterior diameter, and parenchymal cortical thickness at three levels, sir, upper, mid, and lower pole. And then we'll see for any dilatation of the ureters.
In the cortex, in the cortico-medullary junction, are there any features you look forward in the newborn ultrasound, which can help you prognosticating?
Loss of cortico-medullary differentiation is...
And
the presence of cortical cysts, sir.
Very good. Excellent, Harisha. Yes. So you look for these things, that gives us an idea about the degree of development of the kidney. And obviously, you said hydronephrosis.
Yes, sir.
What else?
Presence of any perirenal urinomas, sir.
Okay, yes.
And if there is any dilatation of ureters.
Mm-hmm.
And coming down, bladder wall thickness and diameter of the bladder, sir.
Yes. Diameter of the bladder. So, what is the diameter of the bladder? Generally, it is less, more. There are small bladders, large bladders.
Yeah, in this case, we can expect small bladders with thickened walls.
Very good. And diverticulae could also be seen by ultrasound. What else? Sir. There's another sign which you can see.
Keyhole sign, sir. In antenatally, keyhole sign, sir.
Very good. And the bladder cycling is very poor, and there is always residual urine, and all that you have described are part. So when you built up your investigations, your purpose should be, irrespective of what condition you are, urology or non-urology, what is the target of origin of the disease? So ultrasound will give us about the pathology in the urinary tract. Okay. So now you have got an entire information on the urinary tract. What is your next investigation with these findings? So you have described these findings, and you looked at bladder, partially distended, edematous, thickened wall, etc. Which will be your next investigation?
So next, I'll go for, after the urinary infection is treated, I'll go for maturity and cystourethrogram, sir.
Very good. Okay, yes. So you have catheterized. If the child was not infected, you could have done an MCU straight away. But because there was frank pyuria, you wanted to put in a catheter, start managing the child. And then little electively, you would not like to do a voiding cysturethrogram or an MCU or mixing cysturethrogram. So do you have the findings with you?
Yes, sir.
Please tell.
So this is a maturating cysturethrogram film in AP view and oblique view. So we can see that the anterior urethra is normal. It is elongated and dilated posterior urethra. There's bladder neck hypertrophy, sir.
And if you are asked to choose only one film to comment upon this, which one would you choose?
I would choose oblique view with
So you focus on oblique film so that all the residents can see that, and then you blow it up. We can all see it. Yes. So you have now described it. There are several good findings here.
It's dilated and elongated posterior urethra, sir.
Yes.
This is a dilated and elongated posterior urethra, sir. Here's the bladder neck hypertrophy.
This bladder is rather large, isn't it? It's not a small bladder. It's rather a large bladder.
Yes,
and you can see on the side of the bladder, you can...
These are the large diverticulae, sir, we can see. And bladder contour is irregular with multiple diverticulae, sir. Hello, sir.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, we are hearing.
Sir, I don't know what's happened.
No issues. We are able to see. That doesn't. Yes. Don't worry.
Yes, sir.
No issues. You just keep describing. We can see. So you have now shown us there's a dilated posterior urethra. There's a cutoff and there's a thin stream. Please describe. What else?
Bladder capacity is huge, sir, with irregular contour and multiple diverticulae, sir.
Yes.
And there is no evidence of any vesico-ureteric reflex, sir.
Very good. One more thing. just above the urethra. Yes, here.
What bladder neck hypertrophy.
Very good. Very good. This is bladder neck hypertrophy. Now, we expect a thick wall bladder, which is small in capacity because of the hypertrophy and outlet obstruction. Here, we are seeing a large bladder. So what could have happened at 1 year? What happened by 1 year?
Because of increased intravesical pressure, sir.
Yes.
The pressure might have actually transmitted to upper tracts.
Yes.
And then
the bladder becomes decompensated. The bladder becomes decompensated, and this is called myogenic failure. Decompensated, and it becomes a myogenic failure. So these bladders become very large. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So fair enough. So this is an MCU, and you have shown an oblique film. You have shown the classical features of a dilated posterior urethra. There is a cutoff. There is a thin stream, bladder neck hypertrophy, and diverticulae in the bladder. And there is no reflux, which could be documented. Can you be very sure there is no reflux?
Because
sometimes the non-documentation in MCU doesn't mean.
Yes, sir. Because it is a static film, I can't finalize if there is if the reflex is absent.
Oh, fair enough.
It's omitted. Right. Intermittent.
Both the films and the wins that you have do not show. Right, absolutely. And it looks like the lower ureter, dilated ureter is seen, but since there is no contrast going higher up, we can't be very sure about this. They look like more bladder ears or diverticulae itself. Fair enough. Next. So you have made a confirmed diagnosis. Now, in order to see the severity of the disease, now in this case, the severity of obstruction, what are the consequences which are systemic in nature? Harisha, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I can, sir.
Harisha?
Yes, sir. Hello, sir. Sir?
Now you look for how severe this obstruction is. So, what are the various tests that you will do? You were telling earlier. Tell them again.
So, I'll get a complete blood picture and renal function tests, sir. Blood urea, serum creatinine, and serum electrolytes, so first, sir.
Yes, you can do, both of these things. Yes. Okay.
And then I'll get arterial blood gas analysis, sir.
Excellent. Okay, fair enough. Do we have any information on that in this child?
No, sir. I couldn't.
No issues. So in a newborn, you look for all these things. You have to look for, and a newborn at day zero, creatinine do you expect?
So it should be less than.
Newborn PUV.
With
case
of PUV, sir.
What is the normal range?
Normal range?
Day zero, day one, newborn. Do you expect creatinine to be high?
You wanted to do it on day one or day...
No.
Even
if the kidneys are bad.
For the first 48 hours, urine serum creatinine levels are apparent, sir. They represent maternal levels of creatinine.
Yes, so fair enough. So basically, metabolic acidosis. ABG would be definitely start showing derangement much earlier. And that is what you look forward to. So now that if you have a child who has got all these features and you have looked at metabolic acidosis, you looked at the creatinine, which is high, and now you have to, how would you approach a child? Let us focus on a newborn.
Yes, sir.
How do you approach that baby for the management?
So if a neonate comes in emergency, with antenatally detected hydronephrosis, sir. Then I'll...
Okay. That's a very interesting thing. So when you have a newborn, you have to also, you can look at various features of antenatal diagnosis. So in that case, you will ask the family to provide you with antenatal ultrasound. So this is a good opportunity to discuss that aspect also. Now we are discussing the whole case. So in antenatally, if you have an ultrasound available, what are the various information that you can get?
So we have to check for AP diameter of the kidney, sir. And if there is any cortical cyst and any ureteric dilatation, and if there is any bladder distension with visible bladder wall, and if there are any firstly, or sorry, sir, oligohydramnios. And
changes in the mother first. What are the changes in the mother finding and then the baby's finding? So in the mother's finding, there will be oligohydramnios. Yes.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And
so suppose a child comes to you, there is oligohydramnios, and the family wants to know, how do you prognosticate?
So I will check for the gestational age when the antenatal scan was taken. So if it is diagnosed, if oligohydramnios is diagnosed below 20 weeks of gestation, then I'll counsel them for poor prognosis, sir. And if at all the antenatal scan is done between 20 to 28 weeks, then I'll ask them to get serial antenatal scans done. Monthly scans. And,
very good.
And then we'll check whether the oligohydramnios.
What would you be focusing on?
Kindly
what would you be focusing on serial scans? What would you look up to?
So I'll see whether the oligohydramnios is progressing, like amniotic fluid index is decreasing, or it is static,
very,
sir.
Very good.
And then
very good, very good. So suppose the family tells you that, well, the doctor, you are telling my baby has got a poor prognosis because oligohydramnios is there, which is progressive. Can you do something now? How will you address this question of the family?
Yes, sir. I'll see if the pregnancy is precious pregnancy, or the couple is young. I'll just weigh the risks and benefits of the procedure, sir. If at all I need to counsel them.
What procedure?
So serial explain them about the vesico amniotic shunting, sir.
Yes. So
any other
multiple vesico synthesis can be planned, sir, and or amnio infusion can also be done.
What you are getting at is the family wants to know, can you do some intervention so that my baby doesn't go worsen further? And there you will say, we can offer you something. But whether your baby is eligible for that intervention or not, we will have to tell you. So yes. What will you find that this baby may be suitable or not suitable for that intervention? So it is redundant, not required, or it is required?
So I'll...
mild, intermediate, severe.
Yes, sir. I'll see for the other features in the ultrasound scan, sir. Like if there is any increased renal echogenicity and if there are any cortical cysts along with progressing oligohydramnios, sir, which is not at all a case to select for fetal intervention.
But that is not taken into consideration. What is taken into consideration is the quality of bladder urine, isn't it? So if the bladder urine parameters are grossly deranged,
Which means
the damage has taken place beyond a certain point, then intervention has no role. But they are still good. And the oligohydramnios is progressive. Suppose they are poor parameters in the urine, but the oligohydramnios is static, then again you will not. But if it is progressive oligohydramnios and the parameters of urine are preserved still, here you want to intervene that if we allow this progression, then it will further get damaged, and that is the time a vesico amniotic would be opted for. And therefore, this is one way of looking at it. You mentioned amniotic infusion. Why is infusion offered?
So this is, I just thought to intervene for oligohydramnios with no association of any renal this thing.
No. Fine. That part we have discussed adequately. Adequately discussed that on whether or not the amniotic is or not, the blood is preserved. Those parameters, there's a whole list of chloride, the functionality of urine, all these, and urine, all these features. And we'll do vesico amniotic. If they are not, well, we will not do it. Now we still want to continue pregnancy, and what is the role of amnio infusion? Now I'm asking
role of amnio infusion.
You had mentioned this earlier. Please tell again.
Sir, Harisha? Yes, sir.
Hello, Harisha.
Yes, sir. Am I audible, sir? Hello, sir? Sir, hello? Am I audible, sir?
Ah, you are audible.
Yes, sir.
Tell.
We are able to hear you. Please go on.
Yes, sir. So, amnio infusion is done to treat oligohydramnios, like to increase the growth of the baby and
Hello,
Hello, sir.
Are we connected now? I can now hear.
Yes, sir. We can hear you, sir.
Yes, there was some brief disconnection, it seems.
Yes, sir.
Hello? Hello,
yeah, we can hear you, sir.
Dr. Narayan, can you hear me now?
Yeah, sir.
Oh, excellent. So basically, what we were telling at that point of time, you had already mentioned the role of amnio infusion. So can you tell again?
So the role of amnio infusion is to...
Hello?
Hello, sir? Sir, am I audible?
Yes, can you... Yes, are you can you hear my question? You had told earlier the role of amnio infusion. Can you repeat your answer?
Yes, sir. Role of amnio infusion is to...
Hello.
Yeah, Harisha, you're audible. Please go on.
Go ahead, Harisha.
Yes, sir.
Okay, please reply. Please reply, Harisha.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, go on.
To increase the amniotic fluid, sir. To increase the amniotic fluid and to facilitate pulmonary growth, sir.
Good. And, so what is the constituent of that fluid? You should remember, and you should also remember the features of bladder urine, where a cutoff values, which are good prognostic features and which are poor prognostic feature. At this, flag it up in your notes that you should remember those values. So now you have got a scenario. You have talked to the family, you have told them the various possibilities, whether or not this baby is amenable. Any other type of intervention has been described in the literature?
Directly to the tackle the walls.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Fetal endoscopic ablation, sir.
So what will you tell the family? The status of fetal intervention as far as the valve of the fetus is concerned.
So I'll tell them that if the valves are still persisting and there will be increased severity of derangement.
So they will ask you, doctor, you are very capable and you or your team seniors can do fetal valve ablation. Please tell us what are the risks and what should we expect as the outcome?
Yes, sir. So there will be a chance of preterm labor and chorioamnionitis and fetal demise, sir.
Right. These are the poor things. What other prognosis can you confer to the family?
Poor prognosis, sir.
Yeah. No. So, poor prognosis over. Tell the benefits of
fetal benefits. Benefit of fetoscopic ablation is that the renal parameters won't be deranged and the system will be like pathophysiology will be stopped there itself.
So you can tell the family that fetal intervention wise, you can even do vesicoscopy. People have tried that. And although it is not in vogue because of reasons we will discuss just now. So which trimester is this intervention done?
In between 24 to 34 weeks of gestation, sir.
Second trimester.
Yes, sir.
Harisha?
Mid-second trimester, sir.
Harisha, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, I can, sir. Hello?
Harisha?
Sir, am I audible, sir?
Yeah.
Hello?
Sir, you are audible, sir.
You both are audible, sir.
Yes, sir. So somebody types also. Yes, we can hear you now. So Madhulika is actually sending me. telling me that I am audible. So basically, you can actually always tell the family about these two things. That yes. Well, a fetal intervention is possible. We can in the so I was asking you which trimester you do intervention.
Mid second trimester, sir.
Add it up. So and the time, and the interventions are you can do vesicostomy also, and yes. You can also do valve ablation. But has it made any difference? The family will ask you. We will take risk, but has it made any difference in the outcomes?
So there has no proven benefit for long term renal outcomes, sir.
So the immediate benefit would be right. So immediate benefit would be that with this laser ablation, you can allow urine to come regularly into the amniotic fluid. Vesicoamniotic shunts are prone to getting dislodged very frequently. And but with this urine coming into the amniotic fluid, at least the amnioinfusion will not be required. That's one. Secondly, you have to tell the family that these interventions have the risk that you told to the mother. And a baby gets prematurely aborted at second trimester, the poor lung would not allow him to survive. The chances of survival will be reduced. Okay. You yes. can tell that. Yes. And you can then tell them there have been some early benefits, but in the long-term CKD, there has been no change. So it looks like that there will be a change. Now they will say, what are early benefits? Postnatally, what is the prognostic feature? And how do we can tell that this baby can do well and this will not do well?
So we have to check first serum creatinine velocity, sir, the rate of decrease in the serum creatinine value after catheterization. And then nadir serum creatinine value will be low for these patients. And
very good. So nadir creatinine, if it reached 0.8 or 1, after a period of catheter drainage, it's a wonderful sign. And so at some people say at 1 year, some people say in the newborn after catheter drainage. Either way, people have proposed it. It has not held the test of time, but this is established literature. So you should know as an exam going PG that this is what they talk about. So they say, well, you can achieve that catheter. Now let us come to postnatal. Postnatally, you have a baby, listless, metabolic acidosis, sick child, you are put in a catheter. Now, what will decide to you that this is a child with after a period of catheter drainage, I will go for valve ablation. And in this child, some other child, where I put in a bladder catheter, but he would require more than that.
Yes, sir. When the child presents with septic features, I'll immediately catheterize the child and stabilize the child and maintain the fluid electrolyte balance. And then after 48 hours, I'll send for serum creatinine values. And the catheter is placed for a minimum of 5 days, sir. And then the serum creatinine values are repeated. If the fall in the serum creatinine values is significant, then... Hello, sir.
You can be more objective. You can say you are put in a catheter while we are anticipating. It's not always septic child. A child which has metabolic acidosis may not necessarily be septic. He having metabolic acidosis because of obstruction per se without infection also, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Not always septic. So the reason is that you have a catheter in the bladder. You expect that urine will start pouring in. It is called post-obstructive diuresis, isn't it?
Yes. Now,
but you will find the catheter in the bladder, still not much urine comes out of the bladder. 6 hours later, you went in to see the baby and you found where there is hardly any urine. You flush the catheter, it is in the bladder, but still urine is not coming. What is this situation?
So the catheter might have coiled in the posterior.
I've told you already. Excellent. Think about the catheter should be in the bladder. You can take help of ultrasound to see the catheter is deep in the bladder. You have flushed it to see it is patent also. Still urine is not coming out. A child condition is worsening. What could be the issue here? Do you expect? Have urine in the catheter? Or you don't expect. There could be a situation where urine may not still come.
என்ன கழுத்தில் பிடிக்கணும்
எஸ் சார் தி யூரின் மைட் பீ சீப்பிங் இன்டு தி இன்ட்ராபெரிட்டோனியல் இஸ் சார் மேபி
தட் இஸ் சோ இன் எம்டியூ யூ ஹேவ் சீன் தேர் வாஸ் நோ எசைட்டிஸ் தேர் வாஸ் நோ பேட்டன் யூரெக்கஸ் அண்ட் தேர் வாஸ் நோ பெரிநெஃப்ரிக் கலெக்ஷன்ஸ் யூ ஹேட் அ bladder which was a postural valve which you had to catheterize because of metabolic acidosis and you expected by catheterization it is not happening and the child is deteriorating. This scenario is Harisha,
yes,
it happened, and this happens when the ureters are very dilated, they hold urine, there is no organic obstruction, but the urine just doesn't propel into the bladder. So these are ones which will not respond to bladder catheter drainage, they will not respond to valve ablation, they will not respond to
scotching. Illa
some of these bladders have very thick bladder wall. They has a pinch cock effect. Pinch cock, you know?
Yes, sir.
Pinch
yes, sir.
Cock.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
What is a pinch cock?
So
tell.
Hello.
So as the bladder goes into the ureterovesical junction, the detrusor hypertrophy, it pinches it. Pinch cock, yes, used to be a small clamp which clamp, we, yes, used to apply, and still there is a modified form available. Dr. Naren might recall those metallic, yeah, clamps that you to put on the IV fluid line to regulate them. Now there is a mechanism of ball. So pinch cock was that. So pinch cock. And there may be pinch cock is called somewhere else also. Cock is for the hen, the male hen. So that is, so as the ureter goes through the detrusor, which is thick walled, there's a pinching effect. So the bladder has got a catheter, but the urine is not coming into the bladder, and the catheters, the bladders are very dilated. These, yes, are called Glassberg ureters. You can note down Glassberg ureters.
Yes, sir.
Grade 1, grade 2, grade 3. So grade 3 ureters are the ones which would hold urine like a very big sack of urine, not propelling down. Now what will you do? 6 hours have passed, not urine is known, much urine is coming down, child is getting more metabolic acidosis, ureters are not draining into the bladder, you have a catheter. So what will you do now?
No.
Vesicle or supravesicle?
And you will definitely
answer. Sir, I'll go for supravesicle diversion, sir.
What kind of, the child is sick, so what will you do to child, to the, for the child to become a better case for surgery? You can do something without anesthesia. You can take the child to ultrasound room.
Yes, sir. Ultrasound guided
percutaneous
aspiration. Yes, sir.
Okay, aspiration to one time cheez hoti hai. What you are trying to tell, a nephrostomy, percutaneous nephrostomy, PCN.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Right. PCN will allow urine to come out. So the child who was obstructed, whose ureters were not allowing the urine to propel down, you now have a PCN and the urine starts coming out. Now this urine may be coming out, child may improve because now the obstruction has been bypassed. But there could be a small number of cases where despite good urine output, the child may still not improve as far as the patient's condition is concerned. What could be that scenario?
No, that is after treatment. Now, what about the kidney function, Harisha?
So there will be a hyperfiltration injury with renal tubular damage, sir.
Okay, so this kidney, these are dysplastic kidneys. Okay.
Yes, sir.
And despite good urine output, the kidney function may not improve because there is hardly any kidney function. So yes, obstruction, sir, related to kidney function not improving, you have got so many measures, you put in a catheter, etc. Now he was not improving, you did a PCN. Even then the urine is coming, but the kidney function is not, a small percentage of cases. Now the larger percentage will improve. So now this child, suddenly metabolic acidosis improves, child starts looking around, he feels hungry, he needs feed, and urine output is resumed. So the parameters will come down to normal. So in one scenario, there was no sepsis and urine output was retrieved. And here is a child with class 3 Glassberg ureters. Here, you still cannot go for valve ablation because this child will need a period of time of high diversion. As Dr. Narinder gave you the hint, supravesical diversion. Here you can do a diversion ureteroscopy. So what are the types of ureteroscopy?
So there is loop ureteroscopy, sir, and
Sober's by ureteroscopy. Excellent. That's Sober's ureteroscopy. So whenever you do a high diversion, what is the advantage of a Sober's and a loop? The purpose of ureteroscopy is that urine should be diverted. At the same time, urine should also go to the bladder to keep it under cycle. Otherwise, these bladders become dry cystitis. So you need some cycling. So Sober's would help you. Urine coming into the bladder also, and the chimney will allow urine to come out also. So this is a stepwise. So stepwise, you went up the ladder. You put in a catheter first, then you went in for ultrasound guided percutaneous nephrostomy, followed by a high diversion surgical intervention. This is called a step ladder protocol, and you have taken us right up to that level. So what is the choice of primary therapy? Choice of therapy is valve ablation, but not every baby is suitable for
valve ablation.
Now, is there any other type of ureteroscopy have you heard of? Or supravesical diversion you have heard of?
Yes, sir. Pylostomy.
Pylostomy. What else? Very good.
And
sometimes people would take out a segment of ureter from the UV junction proximally, somewhere in the lower third, out on the lower abdomen, and they would put in the upper ureter on the shoulder of this ureter. So you have the bladder which is cycling and emptying through the chimney in the lower abdomen. This is centrally tight.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And this will help in protecting the other kidney also. Because the bladder has urine coming from the left kidney also, right kidney also. One ureter lower near the bladder, you have brought it out the centrally. And so urine from both the kidneys are coming from one kidney where the ureteroscopy has not been, ureter has not been taken. Urine will come to the bladder and through that chimney to the opposite ureter, it will come out. So this should only be done if the ureters are not hugely tortuous. If they're very, very tortuous, then by the time urine comes to the bladder, it would have already caused the damage.
Yes, sir.
It can only be done if the ureters are mild to moderately dilated, but not hugely tortuous. In very tortuous ones, it is the Sober's. But in less tortuous, you can do one chimney only. Otherwise, you have to do bilateral chimney. Bilateral Sober's. Got it?
Okay, sir.
You got the point?
Yes, sir.
So if there is a huge tortuosity, then lower end doesn't help. High diversion is required. But centrally is preferred because only one chimney has to be done. It can drain both the kidneys output, but it is only feasible if the ureters are not hugely tortuous. So choice of therapy, step ladder protocol, what are types of ureteroscopy? Whenever you do a ureteroscopy, go in to do a Sober's, take a renal biopsy also. Why?
Because there might be any associated renal dysplasia, sir.
Yes, so we can prognosticate the family. You don't know, you have gone in, you can't go for a biopsy again to the. You just take the ureter out, the kidney is there, take a biopsy, subject it to the pathology. So what the pathologist will tell you? What are the findings of dysplastic kidney?
So there'll be primitive blastemal cells, sir.
Excellent. Primitive tubules, that's all. Primitive tubules will be there and they will prognosticate. So we have gone through all this. Now this is only part A. Part A means any newborn presenting with difficulty in passing urine, you think about posterior urethral valve till proved otherwise, and thinking about a wide range of differential diagnosis, you started investigating. So management include diagnostic intervention and therapeutic intervention. Now, there is another dictum. One dictum was any newborn with difficulty in passing urine, think about PUV till proved otherwise. But other dictum is that the treatment of a child or a management of a child with posterior urethral valve begins after valve ablation.
Yes.
It doesn't end. For a PUJ obstruction, you do a pyeloplasty and actually you have taken care of 90% of the treatment. After that, some antibiotics, some follow-up. But in a PUV, once you have done a valve ablation, the whole thing starts. The bad bladder, treatment of bladder neck hypertrophy requirement. So once you have done the valve ablation, suppose you have a case, you have done catheter drainage, everything was, so you come down, catheter drainage, child became all right, fit case for valve ablation, you went in for valve ablation, okay?
Yes, sir.
Now, how will you manage the child after valve ablation?
Immediately after ablation, I will catheterize the child. Mm-hmm. And then I'll keep the catheter for 5 days, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Then after discharge of the patient, during follow-up, I'll ask them to, at 3 months of age, I'll do a...
So what are you worried? So you have removed the catheter. Now, yes. You send the baby home happy? No. You will take some precaution. You tell the family to do something. You will give some pharmacotherapy.
Yes.
What are those drugs? Why?
So I'll keep the patient on prophylactic antibiotics, sir.
Why? And, why?
So that if there is any inadequate bladder, yes, sir, reflux or inadequate bladder ablation, there will be stasis of urine and there is a chance of infection again.
Inadequate ablation ki sambhavna, we should always keep that possibility because there are many issues, technical issues which may come up. So, but if you are confident you have ablated the valve and still would you give antibiotic or not?
Yes, sir. I would keep antibiotics. Yes, sir.
Why? Dr. Narayan hinted you. Why?
Because there would be any vesico-ureteric reflux, sir.
Yes. So, reflux-related UTIs have to be prevented. They give a very bad outcome to babies if not treated. They keep on coming, infection is happening, pyelonephritis, etc. That's one drug. What other drug you will give?
So I'll keep the patient on anticholinergic, sir.
Excellent. Okay. Very nice. Yes. Thick bladder wall. Yes. What else?
And alpha adrenergic blockers, sir.
Very good. Very good. So all this would help you. Otherwise, the child remains obstructed for a long time. Bladder neck hypertrophy is still there. So, in the MCU will tell us, not all babies have hypertrophy, but the majority have. So, even after successful valve ablation, because of reflux and bladder neck hypertrophy, these children remain symptomatic. They have UTI, there is retention of urine, there is a residual urine, and therefore, you have to give alpha 1 blocker, and you have to give prophylaxis for a long time. And then, subsequently, as the child is now recovering, you will ask for certain set of investigation. What are those baseline investigations you will start doing now?
I'll get a post-fulguration at 3 months of follow-up. I will get a urine routine and urine cultures along with ultrasound abdomen and...
Why ultrasound? Let me tell you. Why? Be thoughtful. You are an MCH.
Yes,
why
sir.
Do you want to do an ultrasound?
So I want to see whether the hydroureteronephrosis has been reduced or not. And if the bladder capacity has increased and the post-voiding residual urine has been decreased, sir.
You can also do urodynamic studies.
Yes, sir. Yes.
To look at the bladder, although in the majority of cases, these are the two drugs which are given. And therefore, it is difficult in small babies also. So you can still give anticholinergic and alpha 1 blocker. Look at the stream and observation. Ultrasound will tell us about whether now the bladder is increasing in capacity. And there is less and less residual urine. That's one test. What other tests you will do? I use the word baseline. Yeah.
I'll get a renal function test done, sir. Blood urea, serum creatinine, and serum electrolytes. And also urine analysis, sir. Urine microscopy and culture sensitivity. Or
भी कर सकते हैं isotope studies भी करी जाती हैं. You can do isotope studies.
Yes, sir. Radionuclide study.
What are those?
DM. I will go for DMSS, sir. If there is any associated reflux before ablation in the first MCUG, sir.
Right. So you can look at the cortical function. You can see how they are improving. You have done an intervention. Bladder dynamics is important because what is the incidence of renal failure as the children grow overall in PUV?
Overall, it is 20 to 25%, sir.
So almost 44% will develop renal failure, CKD, by the second decade of life, almost 13 to 14, 15 years of age. And this all happens because of the kidneys, which are already damaged at birth itself. That is why antenatal intervention for valve ablation, it has come out that although you can take all the risk, but long-term function is not improved, because by the time we make a diagnosis, the damage has taken place already. So overall, this is all you will go through, and this is the spectrum of cases that we say. So we discussed, Dr. Narendra, about the differential presentation and what all the underlying pathology is, how you will navigate, she will navigate the diagnosis in terms of choosing investigation, intervention. So as far as the case part is concerned, there's a lot of theory involved in posterior valve also. But in a case presentation, I think that should take care of it. Dr. Narendra, anything else you want to discuss, please?
Suppose after the fulguration, if there is a persistent upper tract dilatation.
Yes, sir.
What are the possibilities and how will you manage?
So that might be a spectrum which comes.
Sir, after this, there are certain comments and also certain queries. Hello?
Yes.
Yes, sir. There are certain comments and questions.
Yes, please.
After Harisha's answer, I will put it to you, sir.
Okay, sure.
Right.
Yes, sir. If there is any persistent and progressive upper tract dilatation, even after adequate valve fulguration, sir, it might be, it might constitute valve bladder syndrome, and there may be polyuria, polydipsia, enuresis, dysuria, renal insufficiency.
No. The question is persistent upper tract dilatation. What are all the various causes?
So the various causes of.
One is valve bladder syndrome, as you said.
Yes, sir.
Anything else can cause?
There can be a bilateral VUJ obstruction, sir.
So basically, the upper tract dilatation is a consequence of a valve which is obstructing the bladder outlet from the antenatal period onwards. You don't expect it to disappear.
Yes, sir.
Then follow up, when you do an MCU, you find the reflux may or may not be documented. So even if non-documented reflux is there, the dilated upper tracts may still persist for a long time. That's one. And for that, unless you suspect that there is a reflux which has not been picked up, then you can repeat it within a year's time or 6 months' time, just to make sure that it was missed and it is there. Now, secondly, there is a condition called VURD. What is VURD?
It is a pressure prop off mechanism, sir, of posterior urethral valve, in which there is unilateral reflux and renal dysplasia, sir.
Right. So these are good cases or they are bad cases?
Pressure pop-offs, they indicate good prognosis, sir.
So in this scenario, because the one kidney has taken the entire brunt of reflux, the contralateral kidney has escaped completely. So there is a unilateral reflux of 5 degrees with kidney becoming dysplastic, taking all the brunt. So in follow-up, as Dr. Narendra was asking, you have dilated ureters. And the child, there is no further hypertrophy. There was no reflux documented. And we just watch up this child in follow-up just to see that there is no ongoing damage going on. And therefore, we will not chase to reimplant these ureters or do anything. This is good enough. Static and follow-up done. Now, the second part was VURD that you have already addressed. So the bladder part, sometimes we treat bladder by anticholinergic alpha-1 blocker, but the pressures are very high. And the urine output is very volumic. That is polyuria. So polyuria, because of kidney dysfunction or tubulointerstitial injury, which is there and permanent, severe large amounts of urine are passed. Bladder capacity is not very big. So this leads to, it's a very bad prognostic sign. This polyuria will lead to persistently high pressure upper tract system and constant damage. So there are people have looked into this by several types of intervention. The wonderful intervention is you keep the bladder catheterized overnight. This way, the urine keeps draining throughout the day. During the daytime, if the child can follow command, you ask him for triple micturition. So bladder keeps on emptying all the time. Still, you find the child has come back after 3 to 4 months, but his kidney function is still not improving. Poor compliance with the family, or bladder drainage overnight is not sufficient. Their triple micturition is not done frequently. So these bladders will continue to lead to damage. And the glomerular filtration rate and cortical function and the GFR and the creatinine, they are all getting deteriorated. Here is a well bladder syndrome case. You can offer another surgery. What is that surgery, Harisha?
We can go for bladder augmentation.
Excellent. Very nice. So these are the bladders which will require augmentation. And also remember, when you augment a bladder, then there is a lot of residual urine, because these bladders, once augmented, can't empty themselves completely, because the GIT segment that you use would not enable complete emptying. There's always residual urine. So if you are choosing ileum and colon, it will lead to a lot of mucus. Goblet cell population is highest in colon, less high in ileum, and least in the stomach, which is also used for augmentation. So because of ileum and colon, there will be not only mucus flocculation and stasis and infection, it also leads to stone formation, and urine gets absorbed from the colon and ileum, leading to further metabolic acidosis. So these children with borderline dysfunction or severe dysfunction, already in metabolic acidosis, the ileum and colon will contribute to more accentuated metabolic acidosis. So I have preferred, and there are people who prefer doing gastrocystoplasty, although it has gone into disrepute to some extent. But overall, in terms of taking advantage of this aspect, in PUV bladders, gastrocystoplasty has not reported any malignancy. So as such, but all GIT segment can have a predisposition to malignancy, but all these things that we can discuss, once you augment and the bladder cannot empty completely neobladder, there'll be residual urine. In stomach, the urine will be acidic, least goblet cell population. So the UTIs are least. Stone formation is almost negligible as compared to ileum and colon. So from that, but some of these bladders will require a Mitrofenov principle, so that these can be kept emptied. You know what is the Mitrofenov principle?
Yes, sir.
Tell.
Principle, sir.
So what is the principle?
What is done? What is done?
It is appendicovesicostomy, sir.
Right.
So we have to disconnect the appendix from the cecum, and then we bury it into the bladder. The proximal end, it is brought out as a stoma over the anterior abdominal wall.
Take this.
So we can do a double Monty or a Monty to empty the bladder in the augmented segment also.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Sir, we lost audio of Bajpayee, sir.
Hello, can you hear me, Harisha?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So what we were telling, that the appendix can be fixed, as you said, appendicovesicostomy, the classical Mitrofenov. But sometimes, if you are using stomach for augmentation, the appendix can also be submucosally implanted into the stomach. You can't do a submucosal anti-reflux implant into ileum and colon, because they don't have thick wall. A stomach has the thick wall. You can use it. But sometimes appendix is very small, or appendicectomy has been done, or appendix is not adequate. Now, older child, to bring it to the umbilicus, although it is still possible, you can use ileum also. That's called Monty procedure. And sometimes a double Monty procedure. You know all this.
Yes, sir.
Sir, there are certain comments, certain comments and questions.
Please.
In PUV bladders with high pressures, is it worthwhile considering intravesical Botox before we plan an augment?
If so, this is a question. Yes, very, very good question, because when the Botox came, people definitely chose time. What Botox definitely does is it buys you time, and you can do cystoscopy, you can inject it, but the effect doesn't last forever. So after a few weeks to months, maybe 6 months in the best scenario, you have to go in again. So there are two schools with experience. Some people said after repeated injection, the bladder becomes fibrotic and no further the injection works. But what everybody accepts is that it buys you time. So if you have a child with a GFR, say borderline 40 or 30, and he has come to you, you can, when you start want to start anticholinergic, then you don't have so much window time because GFR is falling rapidly. 30 GFR, you don't have 1 year time to wait to look for the effect of anticholinergic. Here you can give Botox and the bladder pressures will fall down. Simultaneously, you start anticholinergics. If you are lucky, the child is lucky, anticholinergic will start working. He had never received them earlier and you don't need to give Botox forever. After two or three injections, maybe 1.5 years time, you find that anticholinergics are working and the capacity has improved. And with drugs alone, you can buy that time. So my take on Botox is this.
Okay. The second question is, how will we manage a large bladder diverticulae after post-fulguration?
So when you say large diverticulum, you look at a situation that in the post-void residue, the urine gets hoarded. It doesn't empty. So diverticulae, which is good enough, is to empty with the bladder itself. But if there is residual urine, it is a cause of infection. And these are the diverticulae which will continue to cause infection. So while you are giving your pharmacotherapy for alpha-1 blocker, anticholinergic, etc., these diverticulae has to be excised. And sometimes ureters are opening into this diverticulum. So that is a situation where not only you have to excise the diverticulum, you will have to reimplant the ureter also. Something which should be discouraged in posterior aortic valve otherwise. But here is a scenario where if the ureter is opening into the diverticulum, you have to excise and reimplant. But if it is paraureteric diverticulae, they are holding urine, causing infection, then they should be removed.
There is a question, is alpha blockers mandatory post-fulguration? For that, Dr. Kanishka Das has said anticholinergic after some reassuring post-void residue. Alpha blockers, if despite relief of obstruction, post-void residue is very high, may need a combo. Dr. Mohan Abraham said it is mandatory if post-void residue is very high and safer to give in all cases. It has been shown to reduce upper tract dilatation. What Absolutely. Is your comment,
Absolutely.
Sir? Alpha
Absolutely.
Blockers in post-fulguration cases.
Always. So we ran a thesis 20 years ago, and I have discussed it with my colleagues' name that you have mentioned. Kanishka is our student. Mohan, we meet in meetings. So I started giving alpha-1 blocker, and we realized that routinely, if there is bladder-neck hypertrophy, routinely we give alpha-1 blocker. And we have found that between that group in which we did not give and that in which we gave, we found that the residue was less, the urinary stream start improving, UTIs were less. Within a year, we found the hypertrophy reduced much faster. In other cases, the hypertrophy continued. So alpha-1 blockers should be given in every case where there is hypertrophy. It helps a lot. And a combination, yes, if there is bladder neck hypertrophy, there is almost all cases would have thick bladders requiring anticholinergics also. The combination should always be given.
Can we start anticholinergics immediately after valve fulguration without confirming good bladder emptying?
So the question has got a very practical underlying reason. Doing a urodynamic is not a routine practice everywhere. I'm not saying it should not be done. It is not a routine practice. It is not easy also in very young babies and young families to carry out this procedure. But what is uniformly present almost in all cases is a thick bladder wall, and therefore starting anticholinergics routinely in PUV, nothing, it is helpful and it won't be harmful. And you can definitely withdraw as the child grows and if he doesn't require it. And I let me take one step more. In neurogenic bladder, we always start after the surgery because empirically also, because invariably they have high pressure systems. And that will help. This is the modern management of neurogenic bladder. We should do it. But let me come back to PUV. Yes, empirically, you can start anticholinergic. They definitely help. The kind of scenario we are working in, that the routine facility, the families receptive to getting the urodynamic studies done, all these features come into the picture, and the majority of cases have thick bladder. So empirically starting this, you will actually be helping the child and upper tracts.
There is a comment from Dr. Mohan Abraham, sir. Fetal wall ablation is possible only till 24 weeks. After that, the angulation of the urethra will make the visualization of the wall impossible.
Yes, I think Dr. Mohan has done some valve ablation in the fetus also. So, yeah. And this is technical problem. In fact, the Pluto trial was aborted also because not only technical reason, but also because the outcome, which was immediately postnatally found to be satisfactory, but long-term CKD, that was not making any difference. So taking all the risk of antenatal intervention and at the same time not having any long-term benefits has resulted in that it has not become very popular. But in terms of technically, what Dr. Mohan is saying is absolutely right. The angulation, it is not an easy procedure. It's a very tough procedure.
Yeah.
Very demanding technically.
What are the parameters for poor prognosis in fetal urine?
Yes. So there are good prognostic. There is a cutoff, and the cutoff is you look at the sodium, you look at chloride, you look at microglobulin. You said urine output. So if these are less than 200, chloride less than 90, urine output more than 2 ml. These are all good prognostic features. But the moment you have hyperosmolar urine, and if you have a situation where microglobulin is high and the urine output is also not satisfactory, so less than 2 ml, these are all poor prognostic factors.
So can urethral stricture can be one of the possibility as the child was hospitalized at 5 months of age and possibly catheterized also. So we have discussed about all bladder outlet conditions. So these are all the comments and questions, sir.
Excellent.
So the session comes to an end, and we are very thankful to you, and we are honored by your presence and participation. Thank you very much, sir.
It was my privilege to get connected with you. Thank you, Dr. Naren, for remembering me. It was such a pleasure to connect to all of you. I was very happy with Harisha's presentation, and it is really very encouraging to see the residents who, despite all the pressures of COVID management, they are keeping up their academic top class. And it was definitely, it's a privilege and pleasure both for me. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Good night to all.
Same, all of you. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you, sir.